IVM.
Hello, hello, Amit. I won't be able to record today, yaar.
Arey, why? What happened, Cyrus?
Man, I've got to go to the bank. I have to open a new account. That document filing, profiling. You got to show this card, that card, this verification, that verification. Too many processes. Man, they should have to ease these things up, yaar. There's no way a normal person can do this.
Well, there is a way to do this. All you have to do is you can do all of this sitting at home if you have a Bank of Baroda account.
But I have a Bank of Baroda account.
Awesome. Then all you really need to do to avail of 95% of all retail banking services domestically, just download the Bob World app and use the banking services right at your fingertips.
Oh, wow. Sorted. See you in the studio then. What a relief. Bank of Baroda, we live in your world.
Kripaya dhyan dijiye. The language used on the podcast may not be fit for consumption. We warn you, tread carefully. But listen, yaar, don't be so conservative.
Folks, Cyrus says, and we've got a huge guest today. Huge guest. Big, big name. Only people with my connections can get these big names. And he's launched a fabulous book. We'll get to him in a second. But first, in honor of his appearance on the show, I've decided to launch, I'm going to announce the launch of my next movie, which is called Omicron. It's Only a Cold. Char Din Ke Baad. This movie is looking for sponsors, producers, financiers, and of course, actors, actresses, item numbers, comics, poets, the works. So everybody who's interested, put your hand up and send us to your resume as quickly as possible.
Have you ever wondered where the business world is headed? How the ways in which we create, market, and sell to consumers will evolve? Or if we'll ever go back to wearing pants while working? For answers to all of this and more, tune into Advertising is Dead with me, Varun Dugirala. Every Tuesday, as I talk to entrepreneurs, leaders, and change makers from across business, media, marketing, and beyond, you can catch all episodes of Advertising is Dead on the IBM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcasts from.
In the meantime, what I promised you is a big, huge guest from the business, from the industry, from Bollywood itself, the one and only Rahul Ravel himself will reveal himself. I couldn't resist the terrible pun, sir.
Hello.
Rahul, how are you? Can I call you Rahul, sir? Because I'm pretty old now. I'm 50. So no point saying GV anymore. Main toh aa gaya wahan pe.
You can call me Rahul, sir.
There's not much. Yeah, because Rahul, there's not much separating us in age. Let me be frank. My beard is whiter than yours. It's just it's been shaved by the makeup man here. First and foremost... Congratulations on the new book. And of course, let me tell you, first and foremost, it's a great honor having you on the show. We have grown up on your movies. Also, I did know, I think most people who grew up in the 80s and 90s would know that you were very much part of the Raj Kapoor stable. I think you assisted, was it Bobby? There's the one or two iconic films which everybody knows about. And that's where you started. So, we've got two things to talk about here, Rahul. First, of course, is what do we do with Omicron? No, I'm kidding. We won't get into that at all. First, of course, is a bit about your career also. And it's interlinked with the fact that you've written this book about a man who, in many ways, was your mentor. So, let's begin wherever you want to begin, on the book on Raj Kapoor.
Right. Cyrus, this book came about because I was on the jury of a festival. And Aswani, Apurva Aswani, was also one of the jury members. I used to keep talking about Ratsav all the time. You know, I was, you can say, obsessed with him. He told me, he said, listen, these stories of Raj Kapoor which you tell us are very fascinating. So why don't you write a book? So it just came to my mind, let me give it a try. And I spoke to Chintu, though he's not with us now, but he was very supportive. And he said, Rahul, you must do this. I said, before I do this, I should talk to. So I said, I spoke to Ranjit Kapoor and the rest of the family, all the kids. And then I went and spoke to Mrs. Raj Kapoor. And when I told her about what I was planning, she said, Rahul, you must do this. Because you are the only living person who knows what my husband did while he was working. And if you don't write this book, people will never know what the way my husband worked. And that was very encouraging, and that gave me the final kick to start writing. And that's how it came about. And there's this little girl called Pranika Sharma who helped me write it. So great help. So that's how the whole book came about.
I'm just reeling at the point when which you called Randhir Kapoor little kids. You mentioned that generation's little kids. It makes me feel so happy. You know, makes me feel young again. With others, we are surrounded by these 15 and 20-year-olds who make references of pop culture, which I don't understand. I meet people who don't know who Kapil Dev is. You know, the world is just changing. I mean, Raj Kapoor himself, there'll be a person somewhere in India who says, who's Raj Kapoor? We've reached that point. That's how bad it is. But it's great that you've got this book out and people have to remember the legends and arguably the greatest legend of Bollywood of all time. But I want to ask you a technical question slightly here, Rahul, which is, so how do you remember everything? I mean, you worked with him and all that, but when you get into book form, how do you put join the dots together? Because I know there are a lot of anecdotes in your head, but how do you get that into one streamlined, linear story?
It was just memory, Cyrus. I guess that's the obsession I had, and you know, I couldn't forget what he told me, what he taught me, whatever I was only through him. And as I started, you see, the book, I didn't write it first. I narrated the thing. And what I narrated was absolutely haphazard. You know, I would narrate one incident here, one incident there, and had somebody who would transcribe the entire thing. And then I'd sit with Pranika, we'd work over Zoom, and we worked during the lockdown because we had a lot of time. And then I told her how I wanted the chapters to come in. And then while writing, there were things which, you know, cropped up. There were more incidents and more things. And today, even more are cropping up, though the book is already published.
We'll but start part two, sir. I'll get you somebody immediately to help you transcribe the book.
Part two, oh God. I'm too old now. I'd love to do it if I can.
Rahul, finally, someone from my generation on this podcast, please don't say too old. It's a very touchy subject for us. But old is gold, as you pointed out. So just before we get into the stories and all, and you know, I'm sure there's so many riveting things, so people go and buy the book as well. That's the whole idea of this podcast, that we push that. I want to just remind you, you made a film called Jo Bole So Nihal, unfortunately ran into trouble, etc. But it was a great film. And you launched the career of one of India's worst actors, a man called Kunal Vijaykar. That gentleman is here in the room with me, and he claims that his conveyance for day 7 was not paid. I think it was 55 rupees for that time. 55 rupees total. He's right here. He wants to say hi.
Yeah.
Do you remember
Kunal, how are you?
How are you, Kunal?
I think I'm well, Kunal.
I read the book. It was fantastic. The trip into nostalgia, into those anecdotes, into the life of those people in those days. Fantastic. Really great, yeah. Rahul, I pre-booked the book.
Paid for it.
Well, you are making up for all the problems you created for me in Jo Bole So Nihal. So what Cyrus says that you're not paid that conveyance. I think the producer was right in not paying you that conveyance. That's all I have to say. No, but
I know, it's a wonderful I know. But it's great, it's great to chat with you.
Kunal.
Yeah, Rahul, speak to him. Great to meet you, Rahul.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Rahul, I'm trying to move my camera so you can see he's not wearing any pants. I don't know if you can see it. Kunal, just come back in the frame. Sorry to scare everybody watching, but this is the kind of actors we have today. There you go. Because we're only shooting waist.
I don't blame him because everybody who's working online and you know having these serious conversations online are all behaving the way Kunal is. They're all dressed like that.
So we're getting questions on the text saying, is Rahul Ravelji also not wearing pants? Because now there's no proof. How do we know?
Now, do I let this stay as a suspense or do I show you when I'm wearing pants or not?
You're the master of storytelling. You do it your way. We'll just accept it. You want to hold the story,
If I'm not, let's say I'm wearing pants, it's fine. But what if I'm not wearing pants and I stand up?
You know, we'll have a very long podcast. Okay, let's get to it then. Let's get to the book, A Labor of Love. First and foremost, you mentioned how you feel he taught you everything and all that. And let's also, for those who are listening who are slightly younger and perhaps don't know Raj Kapoor well enough, we're looking at one of the guys who basically started everything almost. Everything that we have today would go back to him. He would be one of the pioneers in the sense of moving cinema forward, storytelling, music, even dance sequences, writing, everything that works. So you tell us. Tell us about the man. I won't interrupt.
Well, as a filmmaker, first I must tell you this, Cyrus, is that I got a mail from somebody, anonymous, I mean, I don't know the person, and he said, sir, must be a very young person, he said, sir, I read the book and I loved it. It made me realize that Raj Kapoor was not Ranbir Kapoor's grandfather only. He was the greatest filmmaker this country had. He actually wrote that, you know. I think Lots of people have been getting this reaction. Oh,
Rajkumar. Wow, it's real. Let's face it, this is the generation we live in. But it's fabulous that he opened his eyes. I'll tell you a similar story quickly. Since you mentioned it, I have to tell you. My dad is also, he's 83 now. And when Saif Ali Khan, he was at the Bombay Gymkhana a few years back, the height of his career. Yeah. He was standing outside with me. And my dad came in the car and I said, you know, this is the famous actor Saif Ali Khan. And he said, he had no idea, blank look. I said, Tiger Pataudi's son. And suddenly everything changed. Oh, Tiger Pataudi's son. So I'm just saying, for generations, totally different sort of, you know, streamline of thought. Yeah. And there you go.
That's it. So talking about Raj Kapoor, I think he was a complete filmmaker. I mean, and the way he thought of things, the way he was inspired, and what led from his scripts right to the release of the film, you know, and this one thing which he said, that if cinema did not exist, I would be non-existent. He was absolutely right in that. His life revolved around cinema. When he was making a film, he was full-time involved in that particular film. He wouldn't think of anything else. Even some of the anecdotes and the quirkiness which he had are somehow or the other connected to his work. Everything went around his work only. And that, I think, was the greatest lesson to learn, that concentrate on your work, don't think of anything else. Just think about what you're doing at the moment.
But you knew him well enough. Sorry, Rahul, to interrupt. You knew him well enough. So are you saying that post 6 o'clock, post pack up, he was still involved in cinema? He wouldn't just take a break from it and then get back to it later, like most people?
No. Right through he was in. Right through. He only thought, and his only cinema was in his mind. And see, his whole way of working, of telling the story, was in a very simple way. He wouldn't believe in, you know, the kind of odd angles that you have a camera hanging in between people's legs, or, you know, in some position where you can't understand what's happening. You know, he wouldn't believe in those gimmicks. It was very simple. The concentration was how to visually tell that story in the simplest manner so that people will understand what he said, what he wanted to say. That was his greatest asset. And the man was gifted. Like in music, any music instrument, he would see the instrument and in a minute he would start playing it. You know, like the synthesizer had just come in at one of the back rooms. I came and said, what is this? And they said, it's a synthesizer. And he just looked at it and the second he was playing it. So that was God's gift. And the very funny thing about the music, you know, there were all these stalwarts. These days. Now, I was a 16-year-old. I also happened to be young and a kid.
Yes, sir. There are photographs to prove it. Please buy the book. Please buy the book. See a young Rahul Ravel at the court of Raj Kapoor. Sorry, go on.
See, I was, when I went for this music setting, for me, it was a moment of awe. You know, seeing Raj Kapoor, Mukesh Ji, Shankar Ji, Jai Kishan Ji, Hasad Saab, Shailendra. Now, these are all the greats assembled in a room. They're sitting and making a song. They're composing a song which the tune is being sung to. Now, when a tune is sung, you always have dummy words. You know, that's like, easier for the tune
like to be understood.
Like any words. Anyway, they don't make sense. But they're there. Now, the words which are being sung by all these people were the choicest abuses you can think of.
Oh, wow.
They were singing
that would have been so much fun.
I was shocked hearing it. And
God, I'm dying to do this.
There were serious discussions on it, you know, that, this word should be changed and this should be here. So, at the end of it, that was not meant to abuse each other. It was meant to make it simple for, and that's the language they spoke and they understood.
Wow. So love lyrics from Shankar Jai Kishan were born from MCBC is what you're, this inside information that I think nobody knows about is fantastic. What a process.
It's there in the book. I couldn't write the entire word in the book. It
Fair enough.
Yeah. Talk a lot of people, but that's the way he was. You know, that's the way he was, and that's how he worked.
So tell us, go back to, you mentioned 16 and all that. What was that? You must be remembering that first meeting. That first meeting was, he was already a legend. You wanted to break through into cinema. You know, he really was like your hero, your idol. So what was it like when you first met him?
I never wanted to break into cinema, Saris. You know, my father's filmmaker also. And I didn't want to. Chintu called me up the day I finished my ISC exams. My senior kid, sorry, I was the last year in senior kid. And said, Dad is starting shooting the circus portion. at Azad Maidan. So let's go there, yeah. And there's some Russian circus girls who come there from the circus. And we'll see them in these nice short clothes. You know, they wear very skimpy outfits. It'd be a great thing to see.
It's why every artist's career starts with the same story. First, the MCBC girlies in prose, and now hot European women in a circus. Yeah, go on, go on.
So I went there, and the pure intention was to see these girls. And when I went on the set, though I'd been on sets before, when I went on the sets and I saw him working, you know, for me at that time, he was Raj Uncle. When I saw him working, I was mesmerized. You know, this looked like a conductor of a symphony. One man sitting and controlling a crowd of 5,000 people who were supposed to be watching the circus. All the Russian circus artists, the Indian circus artists, 250 people from the unit. He was standing there and controlling these about 6,500 people. And he knew exactly what he wanted, you know. So that fascinated me. And I went to the shooting every day. I was planning to go to Canada to do become a nuclear physicist. Don't look so shocked, okay? I think those 6 days that I went visiting him on the sets, and on the seventh day, I wanted to work with him as an assistant. And that's how it started. And once I did that,
fully knowing, Rahul, fully knowing and realizing that in the future there won't be Russian girls in tight miniskirts in every shot. That was just a taste of your first 6 days.
Yeah, that dream, I think, got shattered. You know, that dream got shattered. And then after that working, there was no time to look at the Russian women again. I'm still trying to find them. I need to go to Russia and find them again.
No, 1 second. Sure, those women, you know, again, you're making me so nostalgic because, again, growing up 80s and 90s, we still had those circuses in my part of town, Azad Maidan. And I remember that so clearly. We know the circuses in town because we visually see it while we pass by, etc., and want to go there and not allowed and blah, blah. So I remember that very clearly. But it's amazing the way you're telling it. So you were lured in without knowing it. In a sense, you said your mind was in academics in Canada. You were lured into this whole business in spite of having the family, in spite of having the background, in spite of knowing all these guys, Chintu being a close friend, for example. Then, so how did you know that this was your place then? When was the point when you realized, no, that 1 sec, this is...
See, initially, I joined them because I was supposed to go to Canada for my further studies. And that would happen in July. So, I had a gap from December to July. So, I thought for these 7 months, instead of just, you know, going around only to watch girls everywhere, I might as well, you know...
Watch Russian girls. Yeah.
At that age, you know, any kind of girls would have done. And this
also
is
also
more
at this age. Rahul sir, also at this age.
This age is more.
Sorry. Let's get back to your story. Yeah.
I went to this thinking I'll work with him for about 7 months, you know, rather than doing nothing. And I started with him. And then after about 3 months, I decided that I'm going to work with him full time, you know. Till July, I was sure of that. And I went up to him. And a very funny thing was that when I entered the cottage that he used to sit, it was the first time I referred to him as Raj Sahab instead of Raj Uncle, you know, when I entered. And he used to call me by a pet name. You know, pet names are ridiculous. I had this pet name called Babu.
Stop there, Rahul, because our producer who will join us in about 10 minutes, his pet name is Silvery. Yeah. Also, good Punjabi pet name. So, there you go. Right, sorry, so you called him Raj Sahab and the reaction.
I told Raj Sahab, you know, he used to call me Babu. And the moment I called him Raj Sahab, he started calling me Rahul. You know, he just slipped into calling me Rahul, and that's how the relationship went. And he said, of course, you can join me. And I started working as an assistant on a salary of 72 bucks a month, which after cutting the Provident Fund and the stupid things, I still had 68 bucks in my hand. But started from there, plugged my prelims in college because I was shooting for Menam Joker. And Raj Sahab said, you know, don't give up the shooting, you know, don't worry about the prelims. And I plugged the prelims. And then he came to the college with me. You know, in Xavier, he came to me to speak to the principal. It didn't happen. And he said, it didn't happen. I think the principal was right in what he said. But in a way, I'm happy it didn't happen. And that's when I realized that somewhere he's happy with my work, which is a great thing. And that's how it went on.
So, and you know, I don't want to give away too much. Every time we have someone with a great book, the whole idea is other people go and buy it. But would you... you know, they say there are two types of learning. One is obviously the formal, you're watching him shoot, you're, as you said, the master in the circus with the 6,000 performers and holding court, and yet being in the frame, being out of the frame, doing all that. So that's one aspect. But also you've got to talk to him on a personal level before, after shoots, during breaks, whatever. So do you think that you picked up a lot also, would you say, from just chatting, not just the fact that you're there on the set?
A hell of a lot, Saris. In the book, there's a chapter called Dambara Nights. Dambara was our operator, projectionist in arcade. And, you know, Ratha would never drink if he was working. He would never touch alcohol. But on certain days, his man Friday would come into the theater with a bottle of Black Label. He only, Black Label was what he was obsessed with. And we knew that this is now going to start Dambara Nights. And Dambara Nights was a collection which the operator had made of Ratha's favorite scene. And Dambara Nights played a big hand in my understanding his cinema and understanding him, because I used to stand there, I never sit in front of him, and keep watching, and he would notice this and he'd call me and ask me what I wanted to know. You know, he taught me one thing, is that if you ever have any questions, don't keep them with you because you'll never get an answer. Ask. And he was a wonderful teacher. You know, I would ask you, go out of here. So that's when I realized, you know, how he looked at Avara, Dream Sequence, then Jajesh Mein Ganga Behti Hai, Barsaat, Aag, you know, coming right down to my favorite scene, the climax of Sangam, where that triangle is maintained between him, Rajendra Kumar and Rajendra Raji. So it just went on, and that's, I learned a lot there.
Let's Rahul, let's also look at him as a, from the human point of view. You've also got to see him so off camera in a sense. What was he, did he get angry on set? What upset him? What were the other moods of Raj Kapoor other than the obsessed artist at work?
He used to get very angry on set, and if he was angry with the, he pampered his actors. If he was angry with the actor, he would scream at you, you know, for something you've not done. But that's the way he you know, wouldn't get his actors. He explained to them in a very nice way. So, and he was very angry. According to me, he never had a sense of humor. I think his humor was only what we derived with his antics, with what he did. Because he never found it funny. You know? But he was very strict. And unlike his family, his wife has a great sense of humor. I mean, Dabu's sense of humor comes completely from his mother. So, you know, Krishna Aunty was absolutely opposite of him. And he was angry. He was scary on the set.
But you know, now that you mentioned, sorry, go on.
Yeah. No, go ahead.
No, I'm just, you mentioned Dabu's sense of humor. I'm thinking, I sat on an award show once and he was right next to me and I kept laughing. He had me in splits. He was like the best stand-up you could ever see, just making fun of the people coming on stage. It was just non-stop. When you said Raj Kapoor had no sense of humor, I find that, you know, it's really, that's quite a statement.
Yeah, but Dabu's sense of humor came from his mother, completely from his mother. See, Raj Sahab, I don't think had the time to be humorous. His time was all spent in thinking about a film. So that's what happened. Of course, that time he was by no human. I mean, sometimes he was very funny, but like I said, the funniest thing. Yeah.
Sorry, Dambara Nights, and when he let his guard down, when he was drinking his scotch, etc. Was he different then, or did he still want to sing and hold court, that kind of thing, play the piano?
No, he was very. He was just keep watching those films, those scenes. But one thing about him was that whenever I asked him a question, you know, he would go to long lengths to explain it to me. He'd explain it in real detail. And he told me, he said, you have to ask me. You have to ask. And that gave me the thing to, you know, constantly ask him. You know, every time I had a problem, I kept asking him. And this went on till I directed my own films also. Betab, Arjun, Dakayat, Love Story. When I had a problem there, you know, I had this one iconic figure whom I could just go to and tell him my problems. And, you know, he would solve them for me. He was very fond of me, thankfully.
So when you started making, as you mentioned, Betab, Love Story, all these iconic films yourself, what would be his reactions? Was he very positive when he saw the films, or was he very critical in a good way? How would he react?
No, he was very critical about the films. He would go into great depth to discuss with me, and he would tell me what went wrong and what he loved. He would be very honest about that. He would also give me suggestions that this is what I should have done. You know, I remember when he saw Betab, he absolutely loved it. And there's one small thing he said. He said, you know, Rahul, when Sunny comes to tame the horse at Amrita's farm, and Sunny rides into the farm, instead of just riding in normally, you should have had him jump the fences. It would have been more dramatic. So I think somewhere that made sense. It would have been more dramatic. And that one incident of Arjun, where I shot something with 7 cameras in Flora Fountain, and it had been edited into about 100 some odd cuts. And when he saw the film, Damusab said, the sequence is very good, and how many cameras did you use? I said, 7. He just turned around and told me, why 7? I saw only 6 angles. Where was the 7th? Now, this really shocked us.
Where was the 7th?
Yeah, he said, the 7th camera had failed.
Oh.
So we could not use that material. But here is a man from 130 cuts. Wow. He picked it out straight away. And so that's something which really helped me. And even during the shooting, he would constantly, you know, whenever I had any problem, he would tell me what was right.
Sorry, Rahul, just for a second, lost you there for a second. But what I'm going to do is we're going to take a quick break and bring in Silvery to meet Babu. Babu from the past and Silvery from the, well, his past as well. He doesn't like being called that. So
I hope people are going to buy the book and, read the book.
That's why.
My main interest is that lots of people should read this book. So at least they know what Raj Kapoor is all about. And they know what filmmaking is really all about. And I do hope one day to, maybe very soon, is to convert this whole thing about the way he worked into a masterclass for OTTs. You know, where it's a masterclass and things are explained much, much easier that way.
Wow. What I can guarantee you is our listenership of 10 to 20 people, depending on what time of day, will all buy the book. It's a start. We'll start there. But we're going to go into a break. And in the break, we will play a very memorable ad. Not quite Rahul Ravel or Raj Kapoor standard, but it's, you know, what we can do in the pandemic. And then Silvery will join us, our producer, and we'll talk some more with Rahul Ravel. The book is on Raj Kapoor. You will go and buy it, but just finish the show and then do it. Here's our break.
Hey, it's been another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. This week on Shunya One, Sheila Ditya and I talked to Sumit Shah. He's the founder and CEO of Dukaan, an e-commerce platform where merchants can set up their shops using their smartphones. This is being used by a lot of Kirana shop owners throughout the country and is a really interesting conversation for you to listen to. On Say No to Drama, Chetna is here to talk about the importance of living in the present. This week on Khel Neeti, Madan Lal recalls the 1983 World Cup and reviews the film 83 with our host Rajiv Mishra. On Football Shootball, Siva Sapre and Karthik talk about the latest Premier League matches, Ramos getting his first red card for PSG and Barcelona's draw with Seville. And on Puliyabazi, Pranay and Saurabh try to figure out why India has not been able to become the world's electronic supplier. Do follow us on social media, we're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram and LinkedIn. If you're enjoying this show or any of our other shows for that matter, do tell a friend. The word of mouth absolutely is essential to us. Don't forget to rate us on any of the platforms that you've been listening to. And also, I'd like to ask everybody to check us out on YouTube. We have a number of channels going. You can find all of them on ivmpodcast.com/YouTube. And finally, we'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Cred, Bank of Baroda, CoinSwitch, Kuber, and Intel. Thank you so much for making this possible.
Yes, Raj Kapoor, the master at work, and of course, a master in his own right is Rahul Ravel, who's been kind enough to join us with all those lovely pictures. If you're watching the video of this as well in the background, which I'm sure are pictures of some of the great actors, actresses, and scenes of our times, and maybe from the globe around us as well. Rahul, quick insight into what those pictures are.
The pictures behind me?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, these are basically their family pictures. They're all photographs of the family.
You've got to get an anchor who knows what he's talking about. We always get these 2 paisa, 5 paisa anchors like me, and they just come and build it up. I thought I was going to see Humphrey Bogart and Raj Kapoor in the same frame, but not to be. Doesn't matter. I'll cheer you up.
So let me say hello to you. Hello, Silvery. How are you?
Silvery, say hello and explain.
So I'm good, sir. I'm good, sir. So my name is not Silvery.
Yeah.
My pet name is not Silvery. That's only something Cyrus calls me. My name at home is actually Richie. But Silvery is the Cyrus's own thing.
It's Cyrus's show, so then I've got to call you Silvery because he calls you Silvery.
Yes, that is what it is, correct. You're right.
Rahul ji, isme ek andar ki baat hai. Let me explain it. There was a finals for the naming in the household of Antariksha's family. And they decided it was a two-horse race between Silvery, because the elder brother is Goldie, and Richie. And they went with Richie, and I thought it was a cardinal mistake. When you have Goldie, you must have Silvery. That's it. And he's very upset about it. I'll let you decide. What do you think would have been correct?
I like Silvery.
There you go.
It's unique.
See, the sense of drama, the flair to understand the theater, the cinema world. See, that mind. Immediately, Richie, with due respect, kuch nahi hota. Immediately, Silvery remains in your head forever. Richie is too common. Yeah.
I think I should change my stage name to Silvery.
If you had one more brother, you could call him Bronzy.
And the fourth one you call fourth place because there's nothing else.
First runner up.
All right. Now let's ask the immortal question. I know, Silvery, you know your comedy, you know your movies, you really know everything that's hep and out there. No question about that. Western, Eastern, everything. However, what is your knowledge of Raj Kapoor, that Zamana, what Rahul Rawal is revealing in the book, The Master at Work? You have anything?
I've seen Mera Naam Joker and Bobby. And Bobby's songs are, of course, eternal and super classic. So we know all the songs from Bobby. But I've only ever seen Mera Naam Joker and Bobby of Raj Kapoor, Mr. Raj Kapoor.
But not bad. That's not bad, considering you're born in 1990-something. Not bad at all. Anything you want to ask Rahul, who, by the way, has also directed Kunal in a movie in a small role. So he's responsible for describing around.
Rahul, sir, you were very good friends with Mr. Rishi Kapoor. I think you knew him from childhood, if I'm not wrong. Could you please talk a little bit about that? What was that like?
See, we knew each other since we were about 6 years old. And right from the nursery days, we were together. And then we were in school together, up to the fourth standard, because we were in Walsingham, which happened to be a co-ed school up to the fourth standard.
Correct.
No, but we were there, we were men, sons, and they were co-ed to the fourth standard. Then we went our separate ways, school ways. But we stayed in touch with each other regularly. I mean, till Chintu left us and went away, we used to talk on the phone every day, no matter where we were doing. There was this one call we made, and even if we were fighting like all friends do, the call would be there. The call would be to abuse the hell out of each other. You know, but that call was, and I do miss him a lot. I wish he was here at this time.
Also, great sense of humor. We discussed Dabu, but Rishi Kapoor is well known for his quick one-liners. I mean, everyone has a story.
Yeah. He had this quick one-liners, and the thing I think which should have been taken away from him was his laptop. Because when he went into his mode of Twitter, he would call up. The man would call me up at about 9:30, 10 at night and say, "Rawal sahab, ye bataiye, aaj main kiske piche pad jaun? Main soch raha hu, what choice should I talk about this?" I said, "Why do you do that?" He said, "No, I want to." In fact, the book he wrote, Kullam Kulla, it was a very honest book. I mean, he just did not spare anybody.
Wow. Real insights into, and I don't know, I think, Silver, we've discussed the Kapoor Khandan a couple of times, but really for our generation, real rock stars, honestly. Their stories are legendary, and Rahul bringing it back into, and I'm sure Rahul Rawal's in this story of himself is another fantastic thing, but that'll be a story for another time. But maybe somebody suggested to me
I should write a book about the whole family, about the sons. And I'm seriously thinking that I should write something and call it Kapoor and Sons, you know, title from one or two films. So maybe I will do it. If it depends on how many guys buy this book.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
No, everybody's going to buy the book, sir. We are here to do that. We are marketing experts, all of us. Silvery himself is a double MBA who's now disguised as a comedian. Yeah. Don't let that fool you.
Yes, sir.
It's all about making the pitch and selling. We'll keep saying it. Rahul Rawal's book, go and The Master at Work. Raj Kapoor's story, go and buy it. Learn about our past.
Can't you have Kunal take the book around and sell it across to people? You know, carry the books with him and sell the copies.
Could, but if you look at his athleticism, that means just a 3 to 4 minute job and then he'll be sitting on a chair. So, I think maybe we have to think out of the box here. Kunal in a palki being drawn by five people. Yes, he'll do a great job. No question. But I wanted to just come back a little bit to talking about this entire group and people and all that. What do you If you had to rank Raj Kapoor, it's a very awkward question to ask you, but I love, we do it in cricket all the time, we do it in business sometimes. Would you rank him as number one in terms of his contribution to Indian cinema when we look back?
I would say that, you know, I think it's very difficult to say who's number one and who's number two. But I would say he's among the top choices which I would have. And I don't think we've had a director like him. And with this kind of knowledge which he had, I don't think so. Maybe, you know, this is my feeling. I think lots of directors who might be watching this or hear about this are going to hate me.
Correct. But, fair enough. Okay. I think you answered it through that answer. But Silvery, I don't know if your parents will probably remember this. When we were growing up, this whole number one, when Amitabh was king, of course, there's no question who was number one for a long time. But this was a big deal. Who's the number one actor? Who's the number one director? Who's the number one? It was a big deal. It was a conversation that everybody had, from rich to gareeb. Everybody had this conversation. And suddenly I realized, while Rahul was talking about Raj Kapoor, how this whole style has gone out of fashion. Nobody has this conversation anymore. I mean, the whole world has changed, fair enough. But going back in time, that was a big thing. Who's the big guy? Who's the alpha? Who's the best? And I suppose Rahul has answered in a layered way. So you'll watch the podcast 2 or 3 times and buy the book. It's all about Raj Kapoor, the master at work.
Eventually, you'll see the end of your childhood.
Get accustomed to womanhood.
Enjoy the experience of sisterhood.
Might get to wifehood.
Or not. Choose motherhood.
Or not. You'll learn to define your personhood.
Earn a livelihood.
Change the neighborhood.
And get rid of the falsehood that life post-academia is easy.
So join me, Ritasha.
And me, Ayushi.
On a journey from station starting point.
To station, what now?
Next station. Pudin station. And hopefully, agla station, adulthood.
Fresh episodes out every Thursday.
Follow me at Instagram and Twitter on Bored Brocha. I'm so bored, I need your help. I need your love. I need your touch. Okay, just follow me.
Sarvi, should we go to the AMAs?
Yes, absolutely. There are quite a few questions for Sir. Yep. This first one is about the book. Sapanoza asks, he says, some incidents mentioned in the book are mind-blowing. Taxi scene at midnight, the trilateral scene of Sangam, Prenath's all incidents, and 7-angle shot of Arjun. This one shows mentioned. The genius of the great man. Yeah. So could you explain
also the trilateral scene is mentioned. He's mentioned 2 out of these 4 already. What would you like to talk about? Say anything on the taxi scene, perhaps, would be the simplest.
The taxi scene, of course, it's a memorable moment. No, but again, it tells you again about his thing of work, Cyrus, like we spoke about. You know, this taxi scene is when he came to my house in the middle of the night. I wasn't there. And then he walked out and outside my lane, he went and stood at a bus stop. So his driver told me that Saab is angry and he's walked out. This is 3 in the morning. So I took my car and went outside. And he was standing at the bus stop. So I said, sir, what are you doing here? He said, I'm at a bus stop. What does one do at a bus stop? One waits for a bus. So I'm waiting for a bus to go back to my house. I said, sir, buses don't start till 5 in the morning. He said, I will wait. I said, come with me. And he picked up some pebbles from the road. And he said, you go from here and you threw 2-3 pebbles with me. So I just drove my car away. I went around the block and I came back again. When I came back, he was missing. So I just didn't know where he was. So I took the car down towards Santa Cruz. And from there, near the subway at Sacred Heart School, I saw him in a taxi sitting in front. Had some friend or somebody with him. Ratsa was sitting in between the two in front. Their muffler was draped around his head. His arm was around the two of them there. He was singing a song to them. And I didn't stop him. I knew he'd be annoyed. So I said, but let me follow the cab. So follow the cab till he went home. And then I told the cab guys, I said, thank you, dropped him in. Can I pay you? How much do I pay you for this? He said, Sahab, Raj Kapoor, हमारी टैक्सी में बैठा हम पैसे में कभी हो ही नहीं सकता और राज कपूर ने हमको गाना सुनाया जो हमने आपको सुना नहीं उन्होंने कहा किसी फिल्म में मैं यूज करूंगा दिस सॉन्ग द टू सॉन्ग्स व्हिच आई हर्ड फ्रॉम हिम 1968 दीज वर टू सॉन्ग्स एट रैंडम व्हिच ही हैड गॉट कंपोज्ड ही सेड आई विल यूज देम एट सम डे इन अ फिल्म झूठ बोले कौवा कांटे केम इनटू बॉबी यू नो 4 इयर्स लेटर एंड सुन साहब सुन केम इनटू राम तेरी गंगा मैली वेरी वेरी मेनी इयर्स लेटर But these songs were the thing. And after this incident, next day in the morning, he called me to meet me at his house. And he had a great memory. And he said, did I come to your house last night? I said, sir, you know you did. You know, so why are you asking me this again? So he just smiled and he said, I want to know one thing. The taxi driver, how did they react to the song? Now look, he wanted to ask about his work. That's the thing. So that's the quality he had.
So he was just testing the music. Also, he was testing the songs on the taxi driver and his colleague.
Just to hear how they reacted, you know, that an unheard of song. This is the way he really he functioned. That was a great quality.
I was thinking some passerby may have misunderstood, some Indian tourists from outside Mumbai would have thought ki the great Raj Kapoor is trying to moonlight by making money driving a taxi in the night. You know, just see him passing like that, you'd be stunned. Okay, let's go to another EMA if we can, Silvery.
Sure. This is a very interesting question. Girish Patil has asked, how did Raj Kapoor get away with some extremely bold scenes in his movies when such scenes won't be possible today? They won't be passed till date.
Great question, sir.
Which
aesthetics?
Which are the bold?
I think Ram Teri Ganga Meli you brought up, for example. That was, again, from my, I would call it youth.
Yeah, it was.
She's having a shower in white.
It was an integral part of the film. It wasn't there for the sake of being expressive. That's how he got away with things, because they were there for the film. You know, the story would not move ahead without those visuals. I believe one thing, the censors, even at that time, when I did Beta, this is in 1983, and we had a kiss in it. You know, Dimple and Sunny. There was a kiss. At that time, kiss was taboo completely. But we got it through the censors. And when we told them that, look, you know, this is the story. And if they understood and they allowed it. So I think Ratha, because things were
would you say,
to his story.
But Rahul, is it fair to say also he had such a towering personality and presence and reputation that the censor board were a little worried to not agree with him?
No, his point was that he would manage to convince them. You know, he would lay out the cards for them. He'd explain things to them, and he'd make them understand why he did it.
Fair enough. Let's get one more. At least two more we can get at least. Come.
Sure. Yeah. Next one comes from Prithvi. He says, "Is political correctness in today's era sort of spoiling the essence of good filmmaking?"
Good filmmaking. I agree with him that you know, good filmmaking has become a rare commodity today. This is purely my view, because I said in the prologue that when he said that people are not making films, they're assembling films. That's true, because good cinema, I think, is very rare. There are people doing it, they stop there or not. But leaves a lot to be desired, Yeah. So I hope things change. I can see it changing. I'm seeing younger people coming out doing some great stuff. But there's also some stuff which should not be done, actually.
I think what the question is also asking, Rahul, I may be wrong, is that they're saying that Zaman, up to your time, when you started making films also, there was less fear of expressing yourself openly. And now they're being very careful when they make a film not to take on certain topics, certain subjects, which you won't even get into because we are scared. Is that, you think that's correct?
No, I disagree. Now they have more leeway to, you know, make films or whatever subject they want. We did not have that privilege. These guys today have the privilege to be. You know, there's a very fine balance between, you know, expressing the right thing and then using it the wrong way. So that, I think, is exploitative. And that's not what cinema is all about.
Okay. Point is well made for us, especially me, the idiot. Let's take one more.
Yep. Madhu Sethi asks, with RK Studios being sold, how do you think he would have felt about it?
Oh, that's a very personal
thing. He would have been completely devastated. When RK was sold, which were also the state of the other children. Oh. Even the children were all devastated. But I guess, you know, the economic conditions of today, and the studio was, people are not going to the studio because it was too far away, going to Chembur. Today you have studios which are much closer to home. And, you know, and you've got great studio, you know, modern, completely modern. I think Yes Sir being the most iconic from that. And that's it. But he would have been devastated. I don't think he would have actually sold off the studio. He would have said, okay, you know, I'm losing money, fine, doesn't matter. But the studio is there.
And then again, if he lived forever, he would be making films and they'd be successful and there would be another story altogether.
He would always make. He would. I mean, after the battle of Miraram Joker, when he made Bobby, it was exactly made the way he wanted. So there was no, we never felt that this is a man who's got a financial problem.
But Rahul, now that you mentioned money, for a bit there. Did he increase your salary after that from 72 rupees?
What happened was, Bobby, I happened to be the only assistant director because the other guys left the job. Huh. And I was the only assistant. And then our production manager also passed away. So I was handling production also. And then I went to take my salary and I got 350 bucks. Which,
wow,
to me was a, you know, 350 from getting 68 bucks a month to getting 350.
But how many years had passed?
The first thing I did with that 350 was, it was the only time when, while going back home from Chembur, I didn't go by bus. I took a taxi because I had 350 bucks in my pocket. So, you know, I took a taxi and I could afford to pay 3.5 rupees for it.
Wow. So did you put your... Did you put your hands around the taxi driver and his colleague and sing a couple of songs, belt out songs from Bobby? Perhaps not.
Probably. I wish I had it to be.
All right. Silvery, can we take one more? Then I have to go back on this silly show of us. Yeah.
Sure, no problem. This one comes in from Bruce Wayne. He says, big fan of your film Arjun. He says, it redefined the angry young man for a new generation. What do you think is the reason for the recent biopic boom in Bollywood?
Well, the biopics are being made because I think people are finding somewhere the audience is connecting with the biopic. If they don't connect with the biopic, then you had biopics have not done well at all. But when they're connected, they've had wonderful results like Bhag Ya Bhag, Mary Kom, Chak De India. You know, I think what is more important in the biopic is, see, when you watch a biopic, you know what the end is going to be. You know that this person is going to be victorious. What you want to see is the process, the story behind making this person victorious, and the struggle. I think the emotion has to come across. It comes across from the person. Bhag Milkha Bhag had that, Mary Kom had that. They've all got the same. The emotion content has to be spot on. It's not just the winning the medal. Like Dangal had a great, and that emotional content went on to the climax. I mean, when he's locked up in the room and his daughter wins the award
medal,
and Janaganaman is playing, and that's what he hears, and he realizes that she's not. I think these things were great connect.
Wow. Silvery, are you also hinting that your biopic should be made and that Rahul Rawal should make it and we should find the finances for it? Or is there somewhat in that question, that point?
That's exactly what I'm saying, Saras. Wow, you picked up on it. Great. Thanks.
Okay. Listen, before we end the podcast, let's remind everybody that Rahul Rawal himself is a legendary filmmaker with a huge body of work and spanning many generations. But this book is his tribute to the man who perhaps in many ways mentored him, the legendary Raj Kapoor. We did discuss who's number one, number two, and he's declined to come into that argument, but lots of respect for this, the grand old man of Indian cinema, Raj Kapoor. And, you know, Rahul, not to brag, but I had a very strange meeting with Ranbir Kapoor in Red FM a couple of years back. I was working there for a little while. And he came and he called me all kinds of names like Ledge and Legend and all that. And gave me a big hug. And I was thinking, you're praising me. And you know, you come from the line of Raj Kapoor, Rishi Kapoor, not to mention Shashi, Randhir, all these people thrown on each side. And you know, it's just amazing. I was just thinking, what a family that was. And you've been associated with them. So the question of you making a book on the entire Khandan, will that come true?
I don't know. I don't see... I don't think I can just write any book. If you ask me to write a book, I think I'd write a bad book. But this is something very close to my heart. And because I knew the man, I knew him very well. Like I was talking about Kapoor and Sons, I know the children very well, you know. And I even know certain incidents about relationship they had with their father. And so that's something, again, is close to my heart, which will probably do. Chintu, of course, is closest to my heart. But that's a topic, Sadis, which I don't want to discuss Chintu on a public platform.
Some things are sacred. Fair enough. Yeah, unless, of course, we can pillow you with lots of alcohol and quietly record like we did in the old days, put the dictaphone on.
And And maybe some Russian or any other girls.
Yes, but again, I'm reminding you, those girls from 1968 are now 81 years old. And if they're in the same minis curse, God help us. There's no cinema available which will keep that visual happy. With due respect. Rahul, it's been a treat, real treat, talking to you and learning from you. And of course, I hope people go, I know they will, go out and learn about Raj Kapoor, the man, the myth, the legend, from Rahul Ravel. And hopefully we get to talk to you some more. Lovely stories, great moments. Please write in and tell us about all you want to know. We get Rahul Ravel back and he's going to fill our head with Bollywood gossip and more. Not really gossip, but you know what I mean. Yeah. All right.
And thank you so much, Silvery. And thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
So much, Saris. And Saris, I hope to see you and Kunal for lunch at King's Pavilion any day. Oh, yeah. That's where we met.
Yes, we did meet you. Yes, that's correct. Yeah, favorite of ours, 100%. So, yeah.
I'm going to give you a call and let's fix some time. Let me just get over this COVID stupidity, which I've been...
Stupidity, today. Really? Enough of it. Send it away. About another 2 weeks. I hate it. It's the worst thing ever. Done, sir. It'll be an honor. It'll be an honor and Kunal will be happy to pay. Kunal will pay for the meal, so we don't have to worry about anything. Yeah.
Oh, that's fine. That's lovely.
Only because he's lonely. Only because he's lonely. Bye-bye. See you guys. Have a great weekend, everybody. Bye-bye, Rahul. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And had a great time. Thanks.
Thanks, sir.
Bye-bye.
Okay, catch us on any of the podcasting apps, please. We beg you, we need you. Send us your questions on Twitter, on Cyrus Says In. Or you can email us, even if you're not female, on whatcyrussays@gmail.com.
If you're a cricket fan, check out Edges and Sledges, India's favourite cricket podcast.
The podcast focuses on Indian cricket, the IPL, and has a ton of banter both on and off the field.
We talk about the week's biggest cricket stories with current and ex-international cricketers, coaches, or sometimes just between us.
And it's hosted by me, DJ.
Me, Varun.
And me, Ashwin.
New episodes release every week.
You can catch us on the IVM Podcasts website, app,
or wherever you get your podcasts from.
Check out the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast.
Do you wonder why China does the things that it does? Or want to know how we could improve online privacy? Or perhaps you're thinking about how we can kickstart India's economy. If you'd like to search for the answers to such questions, check out All Things Policy, a daily public policy podcast that covers everything from employment figures to aircraft carriers. Tune in from Monday to Friday for new episodes and fresh takes.